Hi everyone, welcome to our class CSC 316, Fundamentals of Software Development, mostly Web Development. So we'll continue today with HTML Canvas. The recordings for all the previous lectures were posted and we migrated to Zoom instead of Google Meet. So hopefully this all continues to work well. So today's topic will be HTML Canvas. We covered in the last 2 weeks HTML, CSS, JavaScript, the HTML DOM, jQuery last class, and today we continue with HTML Canvas. So first of all, what is HTML Canvas? Those of you that took some kind of programming language in which you develop graphical user interfaces, you learn that Canvas is basically a way to draw images, arbitrary text, any kind of placement of objects, shapes, styling in basically a window. And the way that this is drawn is usually with, it's a canvas, which is a section of the entire screen or the page that is reserved by basically the framework, the programming language, and then the user basically draws into that canvas. There are two different ways to basically draw in most applications. One is vector and one is raster based. HTML Canvas is raster based. Basically, we draw on a matrix of pixels, various shapes. And as you can put objects on top of other objects, those previous objects disappear. This is basically one of the two frameworks that is available to draw in HTML or in web applications. Today, we'll actually try to cover them in not much detail, but in basic terms, both Canvas and the vector version. So the canvas is a new tag that was released as part of HTML5. We'll, in the end of this lecture today, I will also tell you more about the history of HTML and CSS and JavaScript and why the current state of web programming is so diverse. Canvas in particular allows you to draw arbitrary text and images on a reserved space in the web page. It allows custom sizing of canvas, placement of text and images in this canvas, and styling of text, arbitrary graphics. And we'll do most of them today in our lecture. So we'll start with a simple example. So basically in this simple example, you see that I've wrote an HTML page in which I reserved the part of the screen with the ID my canvas. And then I wrote JavaScript code that first of all, it takes that document element from the HTML, my canvas. It takes the context in 2D of that HTML document. Basically, we'll raster this in two-dimensional on the desktop. And then we've set the fill to a certain color, which is red in this case. Remember that this is RGB and basically the first two bytes, the first byte stands for basically the red, and FF means the highest color of red, and then the rest are zeros, green and blue. We set the font to 18 points Rockwell. We set the fill to be blue. Then we write the text at coordinates 110 by 110. We'll talk about the Cartesian space that this is drawn in HTML. So 110 pixels from up down and 110 to the width, starting from left to right. Then we set the fill to be a different color, and then we basically fill the rest of the text with pi. And that's at a different coordinates, 130 with 130. So that looks something like this. Basically, fills the entire canvas with red, And then we have the two texts, hello there and bye. And just to show you that this works as is, like usual, we are going to use VS Code.
It's no. The problem, yeah.
Well, fine. Gonna be fine, I guess. Let's see now. Yep. Okay, so you guys have no problem. It's just me, basically. Okay.
I have a quick question.
Go ahead.
How does it know which element it is doing the fill style for? Because it looks like the same thing three times, right?
Okay, it's actually in order. So it's an imperative language. It starts from it. So fill style for the first one is the entire rectangle, the rectangle that will be drawn. Then fill style, the second fill style is for the text, the hello world text. And the next fill style is going to be for the last one. So really it's executed in the order in which we basically run the different commands. And you will see that this is actually very important in HTML canvas, because later we'll have to reset another path when we draw a path in our canvas.
Okay, good to know. Thank
you.
So
it's in order of how these are executed. That's why the rectangle is red. Then when we fill the style for the first text, it's blue, basically the hello there. And then for this cyan is used for the bye word. So it's just executed in the order in which the statements are there.
Okay, thank you.
No problem. Okay, so this is how it basically looks. So canvas is set with a pair of tags which define the ID on which we execute this canvas. We retrieve the 2D context of that canvas, and then we can draw in this canvas images, text, shapes, and fill them with gradients, with solid colors, and we'll do basically all of them today. You can also change fonts, fill styles, draw shapes and text. Now, when you create a canvas with HTML, you can specify the width and height of properties. And also you specify the text between the start and end tags, which will be displayed if the browser has no canvas support. Now, HTML5 was released in 2008. But still it's very possible that old browsers, especially at companies where they don't upgrade the browsers often, they will actually support that your browser will basically print this, that your browser does not support HTML5 tag. Canvas tag. So this is quite common in cases that you run on an old machine. So let's see basically how does it look in case that we have a height and a width specified. Okay, so it looks to me that there might be problems with this one too. Maybe not. So once you specify the width and the height, basically you can see that the width and the height are basically taken as the locations around the area that you want to draw. And another thing that you can see is that if you modify it and you put some text before and after, before and after that canvas, that is basically enclosed before and after. So it's really that's a part of the screen that is totally reserved for the canvas. They will not be occupied by anything else. It's really just for drawing and you can implement even games or anything that you want in that canvas. You can capture events and you can basically modify the canvas. We'll do that one of the future classes. Today we'll just deal with drawing stuff, not actually responding to events. Okay. So now you can get the canvas and the context, and the way that we did it was we retrieved the canvas with get element by ID, and then we retrieved the context, and in this case the context was the 2D using the from the canvas the get context function. The coordinates are the standard coordinates for programming. Basically, the upper left corner is 0, 0, and then X coordinate for width, for instance, will grow from left to right, and the Y coordinate grows from up to down. So really, when you specify a coordinate like 130 by 130 pixels, it will be counted from left to right and from up to down. Drawing lines. There are several methods for you to know. Move to. So one thing about this canvas is that you have a location of a pen. So it's really an idea that started way before this HTML canvas, when printers were first implemented and every single operation on the printer was in the moves of the pen within that printer. So move is an operation that basically moves the cursor of that pen to some X and Y coordinate. And this does not draw any line. It's just moving the cursor to a different location. Draw is actually drawing. It draws from the current location of the pen to the new X and Y coordinates of given in this draw method. But nothing is actually drawn until you stroke. So the stroke is the method that renders the lines and the objects described so far on this path. You can draw on different paths. So for moving and drawing lines, you don't really need a path. But stroke is the method that actually draws the current path to completion. If you want to begin a new path, and this is important when we start drawing shapes, that you don't want to actually see how the cursor was moved from place to place, there is a method called begin path. This begins a new line, a new path, starting from scratch. Again, you have to specify the move and the draw. So the pen is kind of returned back to coordinates 0, 0. Similar to stroke is the set dash line, which basically sets the dash pattern for the current, the line that will be drawn from now on. Some attributes that you need to know if you want to change them are stroke style and line width. Stroke style is the color of the line, and line width is the width of the current line that will be drawn. And let me show you through examples. So the first example, we reserve a canvas of 680 pixels by 400 pixels with a border of 3 points, solid points, and the line of the border is this blue that you are seeing around. Now, that canvas is reserved for basically the script below. We get the canvas, we get the context within that canvas. We set the color, the stroke style, to some kind of violet, basically this color that we have here, which I think it should be red, it's actually red. And then we set the line width to 1 pixel. We move first to coordinates 10, 10, which is the upper left corner, but basically around 10 pixels below and to the right. And then we draw a line to pixel 550 for the X coordinate and 350 for the Y coordinate. And finally, we stroke that line. So if we copy this code, basically draws this line. And now we can play with a couple of these lines. So for instance, we want the color to be a different color of the line. So let's say that is going to be a green line. So now it becomes a green line. The color that we see up here is basically the color of the border. So of that entire canvas. So let's make it of 5 pixels. And we are going to use a different color. Let's say that is this color. So it modifies a little bit the style of the canvas, the height. Let's make it a little bit smaller, 380 pixels. So it's a bit smaller. So you can basically play with those. Next, the stroke style is really the color of the stroke. By default is black, but you can set a different stroke style. Move to is the location where you move at the beginning without drawing any line. So let's change it to 50, 100. And it basically it's 50 for X and 100 for Y. Line to is the one that actually specifies where it moves to. And stroke is the final command to actually draw it. If there is no stroke, nothing is drawn. It's basically everything is empty. So that's basically the basic commands for drawing lines. You want to change the line to be a dashed line. Only one command is put, and it modifies the entire style for the context. So it basically specifies that from now on is going to be a dashed line. So here is the example. Next, if we want with different paths. So basically, what's the idea of paths? The idea of paths is that every single beginning of a painting is going to start from a certain position, which is 0, 0, and then you start moving the cursor and drawing lines on the screen. So for instance, in this example, if I continue with drawing another line to a different point, it continues from the previous point. So let's say that I want to draw to 50, 300. It continues from the last point where it ended and continues the drawing of the line. But if we want a totally new path that starts from the origin, then we have to begin a new path. So the context, you can basically decide for every context, what do you want to draw, and it separates from the previous contexts that were before. So are separate paths in the same context. So in this example, basically I'm specifying with the same color. So they are on different paths, three different lines which start at different paths. So basically, are three different lines. All of them start from different locations. So the first one started from 10, 10 and ended up at 550, 350. Second one started at 40, 10. So its X coordinate is bigger and ended at 580 and 350. And the third one started at 70, 10, which is here and ended up there. So they're basically different paths as opposed to basically one single path that has multiple lines like we had in our previous example, one of the previous examples. And this plays a bigger role the moment that we start filling with rectangles and other type of shapes. So let's go to those next. So the basic shapes that we can draw are rectangle, stroked rectangles, fill rectangles, stroke rectangles, and arcs. And arcs really include also circles because you specify the X and Y coordinates of the center, then the radius, and then the start angle to the end angle. And it draws it in clockwise order. So basically it can start at a certain position and end at a different position. I can show you directly here. So let's assume that I want to draw an arc. So for the current context, I want an arc. And this arc will start, will have the center at coordinates 50, 50 and a radius of 15. And I want to start at zero and half a circle. So math.py would be the arc that I want to draw. And then I basically have to fill the current, any objects that I currently have. So this will look something like this. Basically it starts, the coordinate of the center was at 50, 50, the radius was 15. Then it started at zero and it ended up at math.py. So if I want a full circle, I would modify that to 2 multiplied with math.py. And we can increase probably the radius a little bit. So let's make it 150 to 150 with a 50 radius. And that basically it's a full circle. Now let's start in order. So filled rectangles. So it draws a filled rectangle, a rectangle filled with the current of the current of the color of the current style at the location specified by X and Y coordinates with the given width and height. So we basically specify where is the upper left corner, and then we specify how big in the width X coordinate and how big is in the height Y coordinate. Stroke rectangle is just a wireframe rectangle. So if you develop, for instance, a UML diagram, like some of your colleagues did last semester as the project, they basically specified X and Y coordinates and then the width and the height of that rectangle. This is basically an empty rectangle. An arc starts with the X and Y coordinates of the center of the circle, the radius, the start angle and the end angle. And zero basically stands for the rightmost position of that circle. So basically, and then it starts drawing with the angle that we want to draw, the end angle. And basically it, in math.py would be somewhere here, math2py would be somewhere here. So it's really specifies the end in clockwise order of our circle. Fills all of the current objects that were drawn since the beginning of the path. So once you basically finish drawing all of the objects, you fill the objects. So let's start seeing examples. So in this example, I'm creating the fill style to be red. Then I start a fill rectangle at position 10, 10 with a width of 80 and a height of 160. And the stroke rectangle, that is the empty rectangle that I have here, it's at position 110, 100 for X, 10 for Y, and then 80 for width and 160 for height. And then basically this is the result of drawing this. So let's run it. And this is basically how it looks like. Next. What happens for arcs? So basically, begin the path allows you to specify where do you start, basically the current path. And in this case, I'm actually drawing three different arcs. One that has the center at 240 by 200 pixels. So the center is somewhere here. It has a radius of 50. So 50 pixels in radius. And starts from zero, which is the rightmost corner of the circle. And it goes half, one quarter of the circle. So math.py is the length that it basically will go for that arc. Then, and then I basically stroke this specific figure. Then I begin a new path, which basically begins, it's the new path for the second arc. And in that arc, I'm setting the center to be at 340 and 200 height, 50 for the radius, starting from zero to math.py. So it's half of the circle. And then the final one, basically it's a new path with starts at, with center at 440 for X and 200 for Y. has a radius of 50, starts at 0, and it's the entire circle to multiply with math.py. So let me draw it, and you will see then it will also change colors on the different paths. And then we'll see what's the reason for the different colors. So this is how it looks. Next, if you don't begin a new path, what will happen? Basically, the moment that you are changing the arc to a different arc, it basically will, and you don't stroke yet, it will move just the stroke from the last current position to the new beginning position. So if you don't actually draw everything and you don't reset the path, it will just, you will see how it moves the path. And that's not something that you probably want. So that's the difference between different paths and the one single path. Actually, one thing that is changed here is not this, the fact that I didn't begin a new path. So let me actually update that in the slides. So here the difference was this, was missing. Okay. Any questions up to now? Let's see. So, okay, good. How do you handle with different screen sizes? So for that, you need to add events because that's the moment that you basically have to deal with events of changing the size and things like that. So you do it with width and height and modifying those attributes using JavaScript and DOM, which we basically did before, but we need to react to events. And basically for that, we need to react to load events and other things that we haven't covered yet. With parent, okay, if you stroke after you begin a new path, will the circle be drawn? It will, but then still, you still have that extra line. So it doesn't matter if I stroke here, I think. So I stroke here, and then I continue without beginning a new path. The output is still the same. Basically, the last position was here, and it moved here. And that's the last question. Good. Okay. So let's return back. Okay, so now another example where basically you can see that if you don't begin a new path and you just continue, it will draw from the last seen position to the new position where you basically continue the drawing and basically you have unwanted lines in your code, in your figure. What did I do? I didn't save. Good. Okay. Next, basically, this is one such example that I didn't stroke. I think this is not the same example with this one. Yeah, it seems to be the same. This one is with filling. So, this one doesn't stroke. Let's see what this, I think this one is still the same example. It strokes the old line. Ah, it does, it basically doesn't stroke. So if you don't finish the current path will not be, if you don't have stroke, it doesn't basically draw anything in that path. We start begin a new path, but the previous path was never drawn. So you can't basically draw it once you leave that path. So this example is actually incomplete. this example. Basically, in this example, we are drawing three field objects. So the difference with before is that now when we draw objects, we don't only stroke them, but also we feel them. So the difference is really that we have field objects. So for the same example that we had before, once we get the context, we feel all of the examples. And basically the three different colors, this is red, this is blue, and this is green. The three different basic colors in RGB. Okay. Gradients. So gradients are basically ways to draw, to color with a gradient, a certain figure. And you can create three different types of, two different types of gradients. Linear gradients, in which you are basically creating, specifying a gradient from XY coordinates to X1, Y1 coordinates. It generates a linear gradient over that path. And radial gradient, where you basically specify the X and Y coordinates, the radius, the X2 and Y1 coordinates, X1 and Y1 coordinates, and the radial, the second radial gradient. You can add color stops during the path of this gradient. So if you want to go through a different color, both in linear or radial gradient, you can basically add color positions and the color that basically you create that gradient on that specific path. So let me show you a few examples. This is an example in which I'm creating a gradient from coordinates 10, 10 to 410. It adds a color stop at index at position 0 for red. So it starts from 0. At 0.5, it adds another gradient of white. And at 1, it adds the gradient blue. So basically, from the first position 10, 10 to 410, it changes the color of the gradient. And I'm creating a rectangle. So now this rectangle that is created here will basically be filled with that specific gradient. Let's see the questions. If you stroke after you begin a new path, nothing will be drawn because there is nothing yet there. So in this example that we had before, if we don't fill the previous, but after we begin the new path, we stroke, really nothing is in the figure regarding the first object. Because basically the first object was, that path is abandoned. The next question, yes, it's actually from Jackie saying that the old path is not drawn. Stroke is applied to canvas, never got called and never applied. That's Matthew is right. Okay, good. So gradient, let me show you the example on gradient. This is a linear gradient from in this whole rectangle. Hopefully, oh, no, it's okay, probably. So it basically creates a linear gradient without problems. The next type of gradient are radial gradients. So radial gradients, basically you specify the XY coordinates for the beginning, the XY coordinates for the end, and then you specify the two radiuses. In this case is 5 and 100. And similarly, you can specify other gradients. So in this case, I played with various gradients. Finally, I ended up at this one with 125, 125 for the beginning. And I said the same one for the 125, 125 for the end, and the two radiuses for the gradients, 5 and 200. And I basically specified that at 0 is red, which is the center, at 0.25 is white, at 0.5 is blue, at 75 is yellow, and at right at the end is green. And then I basically fill a rectangle of from coordinates 10, 10 to 250 to 250 using that specific gradient. So it basically makes this figure that you see in the image. And as I said, you can basically play with the coordinates, where do you want to put the X and Y coordinates for the gradients, and also how big of a figure you want to fill. And that basically changes the gradient and the rest of the figure. So that's about gradients. Text. There are two types of text. Filled text, which adds a text with the current filled solid or gradient, and stroke text, which basically no fill for the text. Important properties that you need to remember are font, in which you specify the size, like there was 18 points, the font family, and the qualities, bold, italic, and so on. And here I have a bunch of examples. So in the first text that I basically draw, I fill it with the color blue, and it's basically a standard text, italic, bold, 50 pixels, courier. So it inherits the current font that is defined in that context. Then I'm filling the text. Then I define a new font, Rockwell bold 40 points for red. And I specify the text and X and Y coordinates, which is at 75, 75 pixels for the upper, for actually the center left corner. Then I specify the stroke again. Basically, I have the last one, which is hello world, which is just a stroke text. So this is not filled. So it basically lets you draw text in that canvas. Similar canvas methods were also in other languages, like basically frameworks. JavaFX has canvas, Swing has canvas. This is a standard way to draw text. Canvases also allows the placement of images. Like for instance, if you have images like JPEGs or any other images, you can specify the X and Y coordinate, the image location, the width and the height of the view that actually that image will be scaled to. And you can basically include an image into a location, into a canvas. So in this example, basically the image is hosted on my website. It's the image of one of the textbooks that we are going to use this semester, object-oriented design. And I basically define that onload of this image. It will be drawn at location 100 by 100 pixels to 200 to 200 pixels. So it will basically will be drawn in the current canvas at that location. And actually this image, I have to put it back. I took it out from the website. So this is ways to embed images. You can also embed multiple objects. And this usually you should do it with functions. So in this script, I'm basically defining a function, display the context, the X and Y coordinates, the style, the data that will be basically drawn, and the fill info, the font info. So basically in this case, what I'm drawing is a field style to the field style that I'm specifying, and then the field text, which the field text will have the data and X and Y coordinates. So I'm setting the coordinates in an array, 50 by 50, 100 by 100, 150 by 150, which are basically this position, and this position. Basically, then I'm specifying the texts in a string. I'm specifying the font. It will be 40 pixels, Rockwell, the styles, and then I get the canvas, the context, the fill style is specified, and then in a for loop, I specify basically, I invoke the method display three times, once for each one of the three texts. And I'm using the X and Y coordinates and the styles and the strings that will be printed with basically from the arrays. This again is code that you can try yourself if you want. And this is how it looks like. Okay. More on canvases if you want to learn other types of shapes are in W3 schools. But I want to give you more about other standards. So another standard for HTML rendering of images and shapes is the scalable vector graphics, SVG. It's an XML standard based on basically an older standard based on vectors instead of raster based. So HTML canvas is raster based. Every object is drawn on top of the previous object and the entire image is kept as a bitmap, basically a big matrix of every single bit and its color. But SVG is basically vector based. When it scales, basically have small images scaled or big images scaled, they look better. It's an older specification and it basically allows also to draw images in HTML images in HTML. And here is an example that I can show you. Basically, I'm drawing rectangles, circles, polylines, and lines, but they are drawn basically online at demand in the browser. And it looks a little bit better. If you look here, this doesn't look exactly very nice because you can see the pixels and you can see that it's pretty basically pixelated if you try to zoom in. But if you want to do it in SVG, it looks a little bit better. So no matter how much you scale in, every single line is quite perfect. You don't see the pixels. So SVG is a little bit older format, but it lets you basically draw in canvas, in HTML. One advantage is that this is pure HTML. So these are all elements that you can modify with the DOM. So SVG in this respect is easier to work with JavaScript. And basically, I would say that both standards are quite used, both HTML canvas and SVG. But I will not go directly in more details here because I want to give you a glimpse of a little bit of history, why there are so many different approaches to drawing and other issues in HTML. So let's go a little bit of history of HTML. In 1989, Tim Berners-Lee wrote a memo at CERN on HTML and the internet-based hypertext system. He wrote the browser and the standard, the HTML standard with 18 tags and released it and the server in 1991. So it took about 2 years to develop the language, the browser, the first browser and the first server. HTML2, the industry exploded. Basically, everybody started using the internet as web browsing and web creation. So HTML2 was published as an RFC in 1995. An RFC is a publication from a non-profit organization called the Internet Society, which was basically a non-profit organized in 1992 to provide leadership in internet-based standards. This Internet Society was actually the result of DARPA funding, the defense agency funding. Basically, they funded the creation of a nonprofit to organize the web. HTML 3.2 was published in 1997 by W3C. So W3C was actually an organization created in 1994 by Tim Berners-Lee after he left CERN. And it was founded with money from European Union or European Commission at the time and the defense agency, DARPA. It was funded at MIT, which is still located at the Strata building at MIT even today. HTML4 was published in 1997 and 4.1 in 2001. And then there was no update up to HTML5 in 2014. So all of this time, basically, industry was racing to build all kinds of languages for the web. And this, up to HTML5, nothing actually supported dynamic, basically drawing on HTML pages. So a lot of company-based languages were developed, Java applets and Flash, but nothing was actually adopted as a standard by everyone. And all of them were discontinued. Flash is actually completely unsupported starting this year. Meanwhile, there was a separate standard called XHTML. There was a question. Yes, RIP Flash Games. XHTML basically was an XML-based HTML, which the problem really was also that W3C was more concerned about standardizing the language and the fact that all documents on the web have to be well formed than actually to develop new uses of these web pages. So XHTML was really a direction to create a reformulation of 4.1 using XML and is no longer developed as a separate standard. HTML5 was the one that finally restarted the entire work on the web. It was released in 2008. It got a W3C recommendation in 2014, and it evolved in the current version of HTML, which is called the HTML Living Standard, which is basically maintained by all the browser vendors. So after many years of battles between Microsoft with Netscape and Mozilla afterwards, finally all the browser developers, main developers, Apple, Google, Mozilla, and Microsoft got together and created a new working group called the Web Hypertext Application Technology Working Group that basically releases HTML standards. It's the sole publisher of HTML and DOM standards. In parallel with HTML, CSS was also an idea. It started really early by a colleague of Tim Berners-Lee at CERN in 1994, and it was first released in 1996 as the CSS1 version. CSS2 was released in 1998, and it basically became a W3C recommendation 2.1 in 2011, so quite recently. CSS3 is divided in separate modules, and each module deals with one of the parts of CSS. So CSS background was actually the advanced to candidate recommendation in 2017. So even these are not final. Basically, there are multiple levels. There is draft, working draft, candidate recommendation, and final W3C recommendation. So many of the features that we are using in CSS are not even finalized. They are basically still developed by these browser companies, mostly Mozilla, Google, Chrome, and Safari. Apple. So these are the various modules. CSS4 is currently in a working group, and basically there is no single integrated CSS4 specification, but from time to time the working group publishes snapshots, And these snapshots are really just releases from time to time of CSS. CSS tags and uses of CSS. And really the idea of why they are preferring to do this is that they don't want to release one recommendation and then if they find bugs to change that recommendation often. So they prefer to just release every 6 weeks an update and then when basically everything has been tested to print out the current state of the art in CSS. JavaScript history is even worse than HTML and CSS. So JavaScript really started in 1995 when Netscape decided to add a scripting language to their browser called Navigator at the time. And that was called initially LiveScript. It was released in September 1995, and 3 months later, it was renamed to JavaScript. And really, the reason was that Java was a popular language, and they wanted to become as popular as Java at the time. Microsoft, in parallel, released Internet Explorer in 1995, and that led to, maybe you know, the browser war with Netscape. Netscape sued Microsoft that Internet Explorer is the default browser on basically Windows and therefore a monopoly, but they lost. Basically, Microsoft re-engineered Navigator, including the JavaScript interpreter, and they created their own version of JavaScript called JScript. The company that actually standardized JavaScript was Netscape in 1996 when they submitted it to ECMA. ECMA is a European standardization non-profit international organization in Geneva, Switzerland. And this basically led to the first ECMAScript, and JavaScript official name is really ECMAScript. JavaScript is a trademark owned by Oracle. So basically we should really call it ECMAScript. To give you an idea what this ECMA is, ECMA is a European Computer Manufacturers Organization. Is basically a standards organization. They standardize a lot of things in history. They started in 1961 and they standardized the ECMAScript 6, which is basically the ASCII or based on ASCII code set, character set. They standardized FAT12 and FAT16 file systems, the CD-ROM volume, C# language, ECMAScript, basically JavaScript, the CLI interface, the 3D file formats, the Office, OpenOffice XML formats, JSON is ECMA standard, Dart language, Eiffel language, and so on. It's really a place to standardize languages. Microsoft, however, although ECMAScript was a standard, Microsoft by 2000 had a wide adoption of their Internet Explorer, and really it was 95% of the market, and they stopped collaborating with ECMA and Netscape, and basically all this client-server scripting was stagnant. The successor to Netscape, Mozilla, released Firefox in 2004 with ECMAScript support, and in 2005, Mozilla joined ECMA. In 2005, also Ajax was invented, which I will tell you a little bit more in the next slide. Google released their Chrome browser in 2008, and V8 JavaScript engine was integrated and much faster than other JavaScript engines. And basically that's restarted this renaissance of JavaScript. And basically that's where we are today. And why Ajax was so important? Because the entire interaction with the browser was completely changed. Before Ajax, really there was a web server that would get HTTP requests from a browser, and a new file will be sent to the browser. And there was basically no need for JavaScript in the client. All submit forms were sent to the server, modified, sent back. So really, there was no need for JavaScript that much. Ajax changed this entire idea. Basically, the user interface is HTML, but a JavaScript call would basically call the server for only a part of the website, which is basically, again, changed in JavaScript, and it would populate the DOM. So the entire idea of doing computation of the on the browser was started by Ajax, because now JavaScript became a programming language that basically did calls to the server, changed the web page, the DOM, and it basically started the entire development of JavaScript libraries and everything that we know about changing the DOM these days. Any questions? So now basically you have kind of an idea why the current state of the web development is so diverse, and why basically JavaScript is so important for updating the DOM. Good. No questions in the chat. And therefore, this is the end of our lecture today, unless there are any more questions. So I will stop the recording and post it as usual. Thank you.